Welcome, everybody. Our scripture this morning is going to be from Jeremiah 17, 5 to 10. And as I was reading through that again this week, several times I was thinking, it does an analogy of the kind of the wetlands, the water along the river and the deep-rooted trees, and comparing that to kind of the barren lands where just scrubs are grown. And it made me think about driving through Nebraska. Now, Laura Lee, but actually this is not a negative. Doyle can contest to this, that I love driving through Nebraska. I love driving along Interstate 80 and along the, because it follows the Platte River the whole way. And especially as you get farther out west in Nebraska, where there's maybe not as much irrigation, you look to the north, and it's just dry. You can see for miles. I kind of love that open flatness. You can see for miles, but it's just dry, and it's, you know, more shrubby growth there. But then when you look to the south, you know exactly where the Platte River is, because there is these huge cottonwood trees that are all along, and you know they're deep rooted and swaying. And I really love that drive, Lorley. But in Jeremiah, then, it does an analogy of those who trust in the Lord are similar to those deep-rooted trees along riverbanks. And those of you who are online or who are on phone, you might not see, but the first image is of a large tree. And part of the scripture, he is like a tree planted by the water. And then Joel's sermon title, which is Seeing When Relief Comes. So we will be hearing more of that through this theme throughout this morning. Before we get on to our worship, we'll talk a little bit about our church life together. So things that are in the bulletin that you've maybe already seen, but you can read in more detail in there. But the Kelowna Food Pantry, maybe we'll have an update today. And Crooked Creek Coins for Camp are still being collected through this month. And if you've ways that you've been tried to become more informed and engaged with Black, Indigenous, people of color, this month being Black History Month, and maybe you can share that during sharing time. And then this Saturday is the Hillcrest Chili Supper, and then the hymn sing at West Union, and another food fundraiser meal next Sunday, and upcoming event at Crooked Creek. So some things that you can be thinking about. Is there anyone here in the sanctuary who has an announcement to share? Marvel, bring your mic around.
This is Joel Beachy. Just wanted to remind folks, we've made an announcement before, but we have a new wireless system in the church building. We're thankful to KCTC that came out. They put in new routers in both original places. The one is where the can closet is, and then at the back of the sanctuary. We want people to know, though, because instead of having EU North and EU South, it's just East Union. The password is the same as always, though. So if you have any trouble, especially as when we get back into Sunday school classes, if you need help, feel free to reach out to me or Emily Yoder or Greg Yoder.
Okay, if you join for our call to worship, if you would read the bolded, italicized line, and I will read the other line. We'll get that slide. Sorry, is it? Okay. Okay, our call to worship. Join on the bolded, italicized. Open our ears
to hear your word.
Open our eyes
to see your presence.
Open our arms
to the embrace of community.
Open our mind
truth.
Open our hearts to the joy of new life. We'll continue with our worship with Heather and Brian leading us in music.
You'll stand with me and turn to number 667. We'll begin this morning with Shall We Gather at the River. In the Voices Together hymnal, as well as in the Blue hymnal, it's in the death and eternal life section. Sort of, I guess, intended for funerals, but it's also just a wonderful gathering hymn, which is how we're using it this morning. Speaking of being together and praising God.
Shall we gather at the river?
Oh,
Our next song is 132 in the Voices Together hymnal, Flow to You. I was first introduced to this song, I'm not sure if it was at Laurelville or if it was at a convention in Kansas City in 2019, but I love this song. It just gives me a sense of peace, and I hope it does the same to you. You'll see that the first part repeats, go through to the third to the bottom line, and then repeat that top part if you're looking at the hymnal. If you're not, just watch the screen. Then the bottom two lines, and then back up to the top.
Thank you, Heather and Brian. I had not heard that song before, so it's fun to learn new songs. It was beautiful. Can you say the confession with me? We are a people born of water and the Spirit. We have made promises to be Christ's faithful disciples and to show his love to our life's end. Although we fail to fulfill those baptismal vows, God's faithful love endures forever. Thank you. Our offerings, our dedication, our gifts are a part of worship. And though we're not physically gathering our monies today, we do want to celebrate the gifts and offerings that you give to this congregation and that help us, this church continue and the broader church continue. And we have many ways of giving. The same, you know, there's a basket in the back, you can send it, there's an online, and our website has a link that you can give as well too. And then just a reminder again of the food pantry this month, so continue to bring those. And there's a wagon in the back for dropping your coins and your dollars, bills into the wagon for Crooked Creek. And the care package for Arianas that Allison has arranged for us, it's down on the foyer, so too, if you have brought something to share with her. So many ways that we give. Let's pray together. Lord, you provide for us in so many ways. May we trust in you and just give a small portion back, but trusting that you will use this money, these gifts, to further your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen. It's children's time, so kids at home, get closer to your screens. And kids here, we're going to just have you stay in the pews yet, but yeah. Sorry, Iris, we're going to have you stay in the pew, but get up on the pew and look at the screen. Make sure that you can see very well.
Good morning. I'm glad you're here. Our story today takes us on a journey with Jesus as he visits with two sisters, Mary and Martha. Martha is the doer. She is busy with the hospitality of hosting Jesus. Her sister Mary is a listener, eager to hear what Jesus has to say. Listen to our story as we have something to learn from both of these sisters. Miss Laura Lee Kaufman and Lucas Beachy help us tell our story today.
Jesus and his disciples had walked from Jericho to Bethany. The long, dusty road had made them tired and thirsty. In the village of Bethany lived Lazarus with his sisters, Mary and Martha. They were friends of Jesus. In their home, Jesus could rest from all his work. When Jesus reached the home of Lazarus, everyone was happy to see him. They did everything to make Jesus comfortable. They loved him very much. Mary wanted to sit near Jesus and listen to all that he said. She wanted to know more about God. Martha did not sit down to listen to Jesus. She had too much work to do. She was busy getting dinner ready. She wanted to make a very special dinner for Jesus. But it was not long until Martha began to feel unhappy. All her rushing to get dinner ready caused her to feel tired. She still had many things to do. She began to feel angry with Mary for leaving her to do all the work. "Why doesn't Mary come and help me? All she wants to do is sit and listen to Jesus. She should be helping me cook dinner," she thought. Finally, Martha went to where Jesus and Mary were sitting. Looking at Jesus, she said, "Don't you care that Mary has left all the work for me to do? Tell her to come and help me." On another day, it would have been right for Mary to do her share of the work. But today was a special day, because Jesus was there, and Mary needed to hear what he had to say. Jesus wouldn't have much longer to teach, so the most important thing was to be with Jesus. Jesus listened to what Martha had to say. Then he said, "Martha, Martha, you are upset over all these details. There is only one thing to be concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and I won't take it away from her. Jesus was telling Martha not to be so busy, even if she was doing things for him. She should take time to listen to him.
Think of a time you were like Mary, listening and learning from someone. Think of a time you were like Martha, doing a job to help someone.
Each of us has a little Martha and a little Mary in us. Sometimes when we pray, we might pray a Martha prayer, full of movement. When we pray a Martha prayer, we might be walking, running, helping, or full of feelings. When we pray a Mary prayer, it might be quiet and still, a listening prayer. Our breathing calm, our eyes closed, imagining God sitting with us and listening for God's voice. How will you set aside time and space to listen to God this week? Pray with me. God of Mary and Martha, give me hands to serve, a heart to love, and a soul that waits and wonders at the way you constantly challenge us to be true to you. Amen.
We are excited today because we are receiving into membership Caleb and Heidi Gingrich Detweiler. You may be asking yourself, what is membership? Well, one of the ways that we commit ourselves to following Jesus in our daily walk is by participating in a local church community. We know that the body of Christ is much bigger than just East Union, but we practice together by giving and receiving counsel, by participating in the discernment processes that we have here at church, and by committing ourselves to each other and to Christ. So I want to invite Caleb and Heidi forward. And I don't know if they're bringing the clan or not, but maybe the whole group, yeah. It's up to y'all. There are several ways that people become members at East Union. We have baptism, when young people or adults make a decision to follow Christ in their life. They can choose to go through our baptism classes and be baptized. If you're someone who's interested in that, you can see me. You can also do it upon a confession of faith, commitment to Christ, and we can also do it through transfer of membership. And Caleb and Heidi have been members of different congregations over the years, and they've been participating at East Union for a number of years, and I'm excited that they're joining us today. So I want to give them a chance to sort of share what's on their heart.
We were preparing, a verse that came to mind here out of Ephesians, which I'll read, and then Heidi will share a few words. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God.
See if we can all stay up here. We feel really thankful that we have drawn from faith communities, both as individuals and a couple, who have helped root us and establish us in love. And Andy wants to say something too. and when we moved back to Iowa a few years ago, we really felt drawn to East Union. We felt like this is where God was inviting us to make our home and community. And You all have loved us really well as our family has grown and we moved. It was just Simon. Now it's more than that, right? And sometimes we're a little wild and crazy, but you showed up well for us, and we hope that we will continue to get to do that with you together, and that we'll all get to grow in that fullness of God, and that it will affect not just us and our family and each other, but beyond this place too.
Amen. Well, I have some questions for you, and as I mentioned before, we want to acknowledge that you have made a confession of faith previously and have been members of Christ Church and other congregations, and we still, at the same time, we rejoice in your decision to become members here and be in covenant relationship with us at East Union. So do you now reaffirm your faith in and loyalty to Jesus Christ as Redeemer and Lord, and to living your life as a disciple of Jesus? If so, you can say we do.
We do.
And as you willingly unite with our congregation, do you agree to worship, serve, and share in our congregational life and ministries, participating in giving and receiving Christian love and counsel within this community of believers?
We do.
So as a part of our welcome as a congregation, if you look to the screen behind me, I'll invite you to join with me now as we receive Caleb and Heidi and their kids. As brothers and sisters in the body of Christ and members of this congregation, we welcome you, Caleb and Heidi, as our siblings into Christ's church. We witness to the work of the Holy Spirit, who has led you to Jesus as Savior and to God as the source of your life. We promise to encourage you in faith, to rejoice with you in joy, to support you in suffering, to guide you in confusion, to listen to the word God speaks in you, and to call out the gifts the Holy Spirit is creating in you. We thank God for your presence in the body of Christ, and we ask God's blessing on you all the days of your life. Grace is going to offer a prayer of blessing to you, if you want to wrangle your fingers.
Heidi and Caleb, we're so glad to have you take the step to join our fellowship here. We also thank you for contributing your many gifts, for sharing with us, and we look forward to sharing more with you in the future. So let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you today for bringing Heidi and Caleb and Simon and Reed and Ingrid here to our fellowship. We thank you for the gifts that you have given them. We thank you for the contributions that they have already made to our church. We thank you that they are willing to continue to do that. We ask that you would continue to lead and direct Caleb and Heidi and their children. And we pray that in this world of competing priorities, you will lead them. You will give them wisdom in making choices, wisdom in their daily lives. May you bless them and lead them and bless their family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we welcome you.
That was a lot of fun. We are glad to have you guys here. The scripture this morning comes from Jeremiah 17, 5 to 10. Last week, if you recall, we were talking about Isaiah. So Jeremiah, you all know this, but he was a prophet also. But I did look up to see timeline where they fit in, because I didn't know. So Jeremiah was a prophet about 100 years after Isaiah. That gives you any reference point. And he was also a prophet during 5 kings of Judea and until the fall of Jerusalem and the destruction of Solomon's temple. So it was kind of a very volatile time, it seems like, when he was prophet. There was political upheaval and conflicts of nations and then falls of great cities. And I think this scripture references some of the turmoil that was going on. So Jeremiah 17, 5 to 10, this is from the NRSV version. Thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make mere flesh their strength, whose hearts turn away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is in the Lord. They shall be like the tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. It shall not fear when heat comes, and its leaves shall stay green in the year of drought. It is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit. The heart is devious above all else. It is perverse. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, test the mind and search the heart to give to all according to their ways, according to the fruit of their deeds.
Good morning. It's good to be worshiping with you this morning. One thing I was just going to point out, I know that it's hard for young parents to feel comfortable when kids are rambunctious, but we put these cards in the pews to remind us that God puts the wiggle in children, right? And we celebrate with Caleb and Heidi and their children. And so just want to encourage them and anyone. You know, when we think about similes or metaphors, take you back to your 7th grade language arts or 8th grade language arts teachers, right? Similes and metaphors they're a great way to express something and help us to understand something that can be difficult. They give us fresh perspective, a new way of viewing something. They compare two things that are often not related, but help us, maybe the reader or maybe us in whatever we're doing, to better understand a concept that they're trying to convey. And what's interesting about scripture, if you read the Bible, there is lots of different types or genres of scripture. There's sort of history, there's story, there's narrative, there's prophecy, there's proverbs, there's the Psalms. But throughout scripture, there are lots of different comparisons and metaphors and ways of describing things. Think of Jesus's parables, or when he describes things like the kingdom, right? The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, or the kingdom of heaven is like yeast. Metaphors help us to have a different understanding of what is being described or talked about. And this morning, the prophet Jeremiah uses this imagery of shrubs in the wilderness or trees planted by water with roots that go down into the stream. The imagery is very clear and stark. Are we going to be weak and fickle, like a dried out shrub, no roots, easy to blow away? I picture in my mind's eye the image of like a Western movie, right? With a single street down the middle and a dusty little one town street, tumbleweed randomly blowing across, scorched earth, no water, no hope. The second image is of a tree, though. Jeremiah talks about a tree that's being planted with roots that go down deep, that are so solid and are easily accessing water. a healthy tree, green, full, lush, well-rooted. It's clear that it is receiving the water it needs and that it's going to thrive. But sometimes I think metaphors and similes can fall short too, because they can't answer all the questions that we have. You know, it's nice to think of a shrub that's been dried up. We can understand that. It's nice to think about a tree well planted, well rooted, that gets the water that it needs. But how am I well rooted? When do I know that I am well rooted, or when I have shallow roots? In this instance, Jeremiah seems to be calling us to a type of faithfulness. We are called to be resilient. In this case, resilient like a tree planted near water. And we know, at least if you've been living in the last several years, or if you've lived more than 10 years probably, or 20 years, you know that resiliency is tough. When the world around us seems to be in chaos, when the future looks uncertain, how do we know if we are planted by streams or not? How do we know if our roots go down deep enough? How can we tell that they're not simply drying and withering and ready to fail us in our greatest time of need? The other aspect of understanding this type of faithfulness is that it really takes time. You know, I was thinking about it over the pandemic. You know, we haven't been in person as often as we like to be. And when you see kids these days, changes are really stark. They're dramatic. If you looked at our boys over the last, you know, year, they've grown like 4 and 5 inches. I mean, many other kids have too, or the amount of words that are coming out of like Logan Troyer's mouth now, right? Like, he is talking up a storm. Well, he wasn't doing that 2 years ago, right? Like, the things change, but it takes time to see those. And when we have a gap like we have, you recognize those changes a little bit more clearly. Jeremiah's voice spoke up in the midst of a crisis. There was turmoil in Jerusalem in the temple, and there was turmoil through exile in Babylon. Jeremiah's home was lost along with so many others. And when the holy city was conquered and destroyed by the Babylonians, he was finally forced to flee to Egypt, likely against his will, by those who had remained to the end in Jerusalem. You know, it's hard when you're in the midst of chaos, or when you're in the midst of struggle, to see positive change, to know if your roots are well planted, if they are deep, if you are going to receive the water you need. Jeremiah wasn't unfamiliar with that feeling. He knew what the chaos was: the temple's destruction, Jerusalem falling, Babylon taking the people into exile. Jeremiah knew that this was coming. He knew that this was going to happen. He foretold this inevitable destruction of Jerusalem. And so he offers this word in this passage this morning as encouragement and a challenge to the people. Which are you going to be when chaos surrounds you, when your life feels upended? Who are you going to be? Are you going to be dry, root-bare shrubs, or healthy, lush, deep-rooted trees? Let's be honest with ourselves. Jeremiah's words are hard to receive. His message was hard. This is it. This chaos is going to be your new normal. Exile will be your reality. He didn't offer up an escape route or a better plan or some sort of way of undermining the Babylonians. Jeremiah wasn't offering easy answers to complex problems. In these verses, Jeremiah preached a troubling message. Exile is your reality. Exile is going to be your new normal. And he asks the question, how would the people of God respond? How are you going to respond? As if you lived in a desert? Or would you be planted in this strange world like trees, rooted next to flowing river? And he suggests that only one response is an act of faithfulness and trust. Again, I don't want to pretend that it's easy to demonstrate faithfulness and trust. Even in good times, it can feel overwhelming sometimes to maintain our resilience, you know, to put on the good face and show that you have it together. But in difficult times, we can become exhausted with the effort. So Jeremiah cautioned the Israelites about matters of the heart. Jeremiah's metaphor is apt to the people of the region where water is scarce, right? What does one do in a wilderness without readily available water? We too live in a wilderness of sorts. Ours is sometimes maybe a wilderness of affluence, of too much. If you think about it literally, we are a place, a people, a nation, a group, a community that has so much water, we even waste it sometimes. We even make it undrinkable sometimes. We have so much. We live in abundance so often, an abundance of things, an abundance of choices. Do we eat at home today? Do we eat out? Do we run to Casey's for donuts? That's maybe my downfall. Make coffee cake at home. And we have all these different decisions that we make. And on many levels, none of those decisions are going to make or break us. They don't necessarily determine our faithfulness or trust or not, but there are decisions that we make that sometimes distract us from what is most important. On some levels, our prosperity has made us numb to the greater needs of those around us. There's so much to the point of waste that one can forget that there are those even in our community who do not have enough, or maybe live under threat or live in fear. Even in this land of abundance, we realize that things are not right, not the way they are supposed to be, not as the kingdom of God is intended. One commentator named George H. Martin put it this way, quote, "It is as though the threat of being an exile hangs over all our heads." Another way of saying it, each and every one of us has the threat of becoming an exile at some time in our lives. On the one hand, we have too much. On the other hand, it can feel like the threat of exile looms with wars across the globe. Exile looms over us when violence is commonplace in our schools. You know, just this last fall, maybe you're aware, maybe you're not, but there was this viral web thing that went out in the fall, and all the local schools all across the country, really, even Mid Prairie, had to heed this warning. There was a threat of possible violence, and the police were alerted, and everybody, you know, decided, and the schools even encouraged, you know, make a decision if you're going to send your kids to school or not that day. Nothing happened, but that's sort of the reality that we live in right now, right? And that can make us feel like we are in exile. Exile looms over us, I shared last Sunday, right? When partisan politics continue to sow division and make the idea or the concept of doing compromise as some kind of maybe even a great evil of some kind. Even in this land of abundance, there are those that are struggling as well, right? The threat of exile may feel real as inflation increases or there's joblessness. Now, even though there are jobs, sometimes the jobs don't pay enough to make ends meet. Some of us may be struggling mentally and emotionally. We can feel on the brink of exile the sheer fatigue that we all make about decisions around COVID. We're tired of it. So I think even though we are not the people of Israel in the time of Jeremiah or Isaiah, we too can feel the threat of exile. And so Jeremiah's question is pertinent not just to them, but to us today. Which path do exiles choose to follow? Do we choose to be in the desert or the rootedness by the ever-flowing river? And I think there's a plea in and a nugget of truth in the middle of Jeremiah, this passage that's sort of a linchpin to this prophecy. At verse 6, Jeremiah proclaims, "They shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when relief comes." Shall not see when relief comes. It's almost as if we choose to live our lives as if we're in a desert, we'll miss when relief comes from the Lord. Jeremiah is proposing a dramatic claim with this call to faithfulness, the ability to see when relief comes, name it, see it, know it. He's cautioning against striving against the exiles of our day. Instead, he's urging us to see exile as a matter of the heart. So whether we are physically without a job or not, whether we are physically without the things that we need or not, whether we are emotionally spent or not, whether we feel well-rooted and planted and receiving the water that we need is a matter of the heart. His prophecy is not then just for the decision makers, the leaders, the rulers. Jeremiah's warnings, unlike some other prophets, are not talking to the kings and the high priests. He's urging everyone, all of us, to consider where our hearts and our minds are planted. Again, whereas some prophecies are really about the modern day structures, or the structures and the governments and the principalities that cause degradation and pain in people, Jeremiah's prophecy right in this text is more personal. He's suggesting that the Lord is going to test the mind and the heart in verse 10. And each and every person has the opportunity to have wholeness, to have restoration, and that begins in the heart of each individual. And I really think it's separately a call to commitment. This week, a number of us pastors were gathered together and talking and thinking about, you know, the state of church, right? And one of the things that we were talking about is how are we committing ourselves to be the body of Christ together? In our local churches, as churches working together in the community, and then beyond, in the conferences and denominations, whether it's Mennonite Church USA or Central Plains, or if it's the Methodists or the Lutherans or any other group of people, this idea of being committed is a little bit like being planted, well-rooted next to water. Yesterday, our family went up and supported Ava as she was doing archery. If you haven't been to an archery contest, it's really fascinating. But there were 48 kids or youth or high school students there, all the way from, I think, fifth grade up to seniors in high school, right? And they're all side by side, and you're going up against everybody. So it doesn't matter who you're standing next to. And each person, they buzz, and then you have about 2 minutes to let off five shots, and they do it three rounds at 15 meters and three rounds at 20 meters. Sorry, 10 and 15. I was off by five. There you go. 10 and 15 meters, right? But what's the reason why I was thinking about it is because there is a commitment that has to be made. You have to be singularly focused on this target. There's all these other people, everything's quiet, and you're pulling back and you're aiming and you're focusing and you're trying to hit this target. It takes commitment. That's my metaphor for the day. A more literal metaphor is Caleb and Heidi's choice this morning, right? To they've already been attending East Union, but they choose to become members and commit themselves to this group of people. Each of us, whether we're members or not, have a chance to gather and choose to be committed to each other, even when things are rough, even when it feels like we're in exile, even when it feels like we may be in a desert time. So how are you going to know if you are well-rooted this week? How can you decide to live next to the stream rather than in the desert? Last week at the close of my sermon, I said these words, and I'd like to offer them to y'all again. May we have the wherewithal to stay faithful through these difficult times. God may test our hearts and our minds, but may we receive this testing with trust, knowing that God is going to be faithful as well. May we choose to be trees firmly planted, and may our security be in our rootedness in Jesus. May it be so.
Please stand with me if you are able and turn to number 514, I Saw a Tree.
I'm going to go to the river.
Now it's time for Signs of Hope.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life.
Now receive this benediction blessing. God, you root those who trust in you by streams of healing water. Release us from the bonds of disease. Free us from the power of evil. And turn us from falsehood and illusion, that we may find the blessing of new life in you through the power of Jesus Christ. Amen. Go in peace.